Good morning, welcome to worship. The Major accused me of being keen there, because Major Morris said, do we have time to play the march? And I said, yes. So somebody wanted it anyway. But, it's good to see you all worshiping with us. Good to see Harry and Vivian, and good to see John McCready as well worshiping with us today. The flowers today are in memory of my mum, Major Betty Wall, for myself, Jill, and the family. The activities during the week, the Cameo Club are having a day out to Roker tomorrow. Just a Cameo Club time out to Roker. Excellent. We don't want people to turn up too early, do we? That's lovely. And then the House Fellowship tomorrow evening, by Zoom as usual, is at 7:30. Just some announcements of upcoming events. The Songs of Praise, which had its date changed, if you remember, is now on Sunday the 3rd of July, and that will be united in this hall with Cairo Street at 5:30. And then we're looking forward to the Strawberry Fair, so the first announcement of that, which is on Thursday the 21st of July, and that's at 7 p.m. And then just one more announcement. You'll see in the newsletter information from John Clasper on the possibility of us going down as a corps to the annual carol service on the 7th of December. You'll see further information today, and there's some newsletters at the back if you haven't got it yet. And John explains that the carol service on the Wednesday, we would travel down on the Tuesday, stay over, travel back on the Thursday. But he's looking in the next couple of weeks to finalise the numbers so that he can decide if it's viable and to work out the arrangements. So please see John if you're interested in that. May the Lord bless you.
Good morning. How are we all feeling? Good? Fine? You're all looking eager and in anticipation of what's come. Good. This morning, we're looking at Ezekiel, and I've entitled it Ezekiel Part 1. Because 2 weeks ago, basically after the last meeting I led, I knew exactly what I was to preach on. And God has challenged me with this because I'm looking at the value of the dry bones on this part, and I'm looking at the watering out the temple in a couple of weeks' time. But it's not an easy piece of scripture to get your head around. When you look at it, it's really, really challenging, and we will look at that a little bit later on. But we're going to commence worship. We started worship this morning at the prayer meeting. We're going to continue worship as we sing one of Graham Kendrick's songs, Far and Near, Hear the Call. Worship Him, Lord of All. Do we know this one?
Yes.
No?
Yes.
Well, we should recognize it. The band played it before the march. It's the first and second verse together, then we've got the chorus, the third verse of chorus. When in doubt, follow the band. Many a salvationist who's given his testimony said, when in doubt, I followed the band and got saved. So why not? When in doubt, follow the band. And if it goes wrong, we follow the band. So let's stand and let's sing together, shall we, friends?
Thank you. Send your spirit on us afresh, Father God, that you could use us to make a difference in our families, in our communities, and in this city. So, Father God, be with us today and for the rest of this meeting. This we ask in faith through your dear Son's name. Amen. And now we're going to listen to the message from the band. Thank you.
The same God who calls us to shout out our praises and say it loud is the same God who comes to us in a very personal way. And we can talk to him in prayer, bring our thoughts, our feelings, our worries, our concerns, because he's the God who cares for each one of us. I know he cares for me, for I trust my Father in heaven. For I know that he cares for me.
Thank you.
cares for me. Now it's the first song, because someone wants to start introducing next time about the school. It's, I don't
call to lead. This is met with the affirming answer, Christ has the right of love, love which demands the whole. Dear Lord, I give without reserve my heart, my life, my soul.
To these bones, prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. And you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come, breathe from the four winds, and breathe into these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up, and our hope is gone, and we are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says. My people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I am the Lord. I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord. Amen.
Let's pray, shall we? Father God, you are able, you are more than able to accomplish what concerns us. And Lord, what concerns us today is many things. We just need to look at the news report and see how this world is in turmoil. And we just pray, Father God, that common sense would seem to prevail, that the evil in this world would be defeated, that stability could happen again. We look closer to home, Father God, and we look at our own country. And we just pray for integrity and leadership and honesty. We pray for those in authority over us and ask that you would help them to fulfill their duties to the best of their abilities. We come to our own city, Father God, and where we see such a mix of wealth and deprivation. And we just pray, Father God, that you could help us to be the answer to people's prayers. We also look at our own fellowship, Father God, and just pray for those who need your support just now, that your help just now, and especially in this coming week. We pray for those of our fellowship who would love to be here but just need your healing hand upon their lives. And Father God, we pray to you, we bring all these things to you because you are more than able. You are a great God. You are a God of miracles, of wonders, and of healing. And we lay them before you just now. And ask, Father God, that in your will be done. Father God, in your mercy, hear and answer prayer just now, this we ask. Amen and amen. Friends, before we look at that text of scripture from Ezekiel, we're going to be blessed as we listen to the message from the songsters. Thank you.
Jill and the songsters for your ministry to us this morning. Ezekiel part 1. Have many of you read Ezekiel? Perhaps as part of a daily reading? It's one of those strange passages of scripture. So I want to give you a 100-year history lesson in about 90 seconds, because it's important to understand the context on which this was written. You understand that you had Israel and Judah, Israel in the north, the northern 10 tribes, Judah in the south. The 10 tribes had fallen to the Assyrians in about 721, 722 BC. So you had the remaining kingdom of Judah in the south. So you had tribe of Judah and the tribe of Benjamin in the south, living with this constant threat of it could happen to us. There could be another invasion. To the east, you had a growing Egypt wanting to recapture some of its power of the fallen of former years. And to the west, you had Babylon starting to rise and get important. Babylon eventually conquered the Assyrians and continued to move east, and Egypt moved west because Egypt had supported the Assyrians. Alliances were forged, broken, battles forced and lost with standoffs. To be a Jew, to be faithful Jew, was not easy. Excuse my pronunciation of some of these words. The king of Judah, Joash, who was allied to Babylon originally, was defeated by the Egyptians. His son, Jehoaz, was crowned and ruled for 3 months until Pharaoh Necho came and installed Jehoiakim as ruler of Jerusalem. Now, Nebuchadnezzar was elevated to the king of Babylon in the same year. Jehoiakim started to switch allegiances from Egypt to Nebuchadnezzar. So there was this flip-flopping of allegiances as Judah was caught in the middle of these two superpowers. A few years later, there was a standoff battle between Babylon and Egypt, where Jehoiakim switched allegiances again, and this proved the beginning and the end for Judah. Babylon sent a force, subdued Judah, conquered it in about 597 BC, and 10,000 were sent into exile. The king was killed, the king's son, and Ezekiel was sent into exile. Zedekiah, the king's uncle, was placed on the throne, but after a few years he rebelled, and eventually the Babylonians came, attacked again, destroyed the temple, destroyed the walls, and that was the end of the monarchy in about 586. So this scripture was written after 586. To be a Jew, a faithful Jew, was not easy. You're a conquered people. You're a crushed people. The symbolism of God's almighty power on earth, the temple, had been burned. And you were in exile. Boney M. amazingly sang about by the rivers of Babylon. Anyone old enough to remember that? Where the Babylonians were saying, sing your songs, play your harps. Taken from scripture. This is referring to that second exile, where the 10,000 were dragged out of what they thought was home and life into captivity. And they weren't treated well. Life was hard under the Babylonians. So this message that Ezekiel tells them, for them, would they be listening to it with hopes of God's got to do something? Or would they be saying, no, it's too late? God said to Ezekiel, I want you to say this. You heard the scripture reading that Brian read about the value of the dry bones. It's strange reading. Strange reading indeed. When you look at this, the back, you see a tired people, a broken people, the way of life had changed. Their faith could be shattered. Their captors ridiculing them, living in a strange land, speaking strange languages. And they could have been praying and praying and praying, saying, God, why have you allowed this to happen? Ezekiel said, dry bones, listen to the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says. Look, I'm going to put breath into you and make you live again. I'll put flesh on your muscles and cover you with skin. I will put breath into you and you'll come to life. Then you will know that I'm the Lord, your God. In other words, God was going to do something. He was going to rebuild the people. He's going to save them. As Ezekiel prophesied, as we can read in scripture, you could hear rattling. The bones were then moving back together, back into the right place where they wanted to be. Then muscle appeared, then skin. And they were there as humans, but without being alive. And this is symbolic, going back all the way to the Old Testament, looking at Adam, who was made from the dust of the earth and was there molded into a person, but wasn't alive until God breathed life into him. God tells Ezekiel to go and prophesy to these lifeless bodies that moments before were bones. Ezekiel says in verse 9, this is what the sovereign Lord says, come, O breath, from the four winds, breathe into these dead bodies so they may live again. Then God says, these bones represent the people of Israel. They're saying, we have become like dry bones, all our hope is gone, our nation is finished. And this is where I feel that many people today could be. Tired. Busy with life. I don't know about you, but in the morning I've got aching bones. Busy just doing what they do. Lots of people are not anti-God or anti-church. They just don't think of it anymore. They just do what they do. They get on with their life. They need the word of God in their life, the breath of God in their life. So that's why God has given me this text, this scripture, that we can take from this, that God is not finished with his church, that God is not finished with this world, that he will breathe new life into us. God says, I will bring you back to the land of Israel. When this happens, your people will know that I am the Lord God. I will put my spirit in you. Then you will know that the Lord has spoken, and I have done what I have said. God will restore them as people and as a nation so that the world will know that God is God. I believe that God is challenging us today with this very text, saying to us as individuals, saying to this world who may be like the valley of the dry bones, shattered and broken, like bodies without breath, that God will restore us. Bring us back home to where he wants us to be, doing what he wants us to do. Then the Lord will have his will complete and people see that God is God. I feel it's a word for our corps, our army as well. That God will breathe new life into us, bring us back into a closer relationship with him, closer than we've ever been before. So much so that our city will stop and wonder, what on earth is going on? Because we have an amazing God who will do the impossible. Because they see what God is doing again. I will put my spirit in you, and you will live again. Jesus echoed this in John 10:10 when he said that God has come to give us life in all its fullness. The Israelites were restored. Not restored to what was. They didn't restore the monarchy. The country wasn't restored in the way that the people wanted. And we can see that in scripture as we look towards Jesus. They wanted the Messiah to come and restore the glory days. That wasn't how it was restored. They became different. And different in a way that allowed the pathway for Jesus. They were not just an isolated people, but a dispersed people. They had a stronger grounding in their faith because of their tribulations. They became the bedrock on which Christianity was allowed to be established and happened 500 years later. They became a people of faith that sustained them for 2,500 years through so much persecution in history. I don't think there's another people in the entire history of the world has been so persecuted as the Jews. And they survived this and borne this because of their relationship with God and their faith. They haven't just survived, they've thrived. I believe God is saying to us as a core and as individuals that he will put his Holy Spirit on us again. And they will not just survive, will not just get by, but will thrive. because we'll become something different and new. Not a recreation of what was, but a birthing of what is to be, what God wants us to be. And it starts with that journey, a journey of faith, a leap of faith, a step into the unknown. The Chinese proverb says the longest journey in the world starts with that first step. Just like the 10,000 Jews carried off into captivity, they thought this was the end. It wasn't. It was a start of a finding and affirming of their faith, growing the nation's identity and character, a strengthening of their belief, a strengthening of their understanding in God, the God who brought them from Egypt, who parted the sea, who guided them through 40 years of wandering in the desert, did something even more amazing. He set the scene to allow the world to be turned upside down with the teachings of Jesus. How are you really feeling coming out of a pandemic? Do you feel like those bones? Do you feel like Jesus said in Matthew's gospel? Are you tired? Worn out, burnt out in religion? Come to me, get away with me, and you recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me, and you'll learn how to live freely and lightly. When you look at this world and see chaos, it's like that of Ezekiel's day. Nations warring, other nations caught in the middle of a bigger game in the world politics. Life is both hard and difficult. A nation worried and changed forever. And yes, God says, I will put my spirit on you and you will live again. I wonder when you look about at your home, the rising cost of energy, of heating, food prices, but that's all secondary to the souls of men and women, boys and girls who are being lost because perhaps we're more like the valley of dry bones than we need to be. We're needing God's breath into our lives again, needing to be restored into what God wants us to be in order for us to go make a difference in this city, in our community, in our families. It's going to be a whirlwind of a journey. It's going to be hard. Are we all going to be happy? No, because it involves change. And if we don't, we just don't like change. We like to be comfortable doing what we do. But like those dry bones, they are prophesied to, they move to where they need to be restored. Then God breathes new life into them, showing them that God's not stopping with the individual, but restoring the people. You may ask, what right on earth does God have to do all this? This illustration may help. At the end of time, billions of people were scattered across a vast plain before God's throne. Some talked heatedly. How can God judge us? What does he know about suffering? A young woman complained. She jerked back her sleeve to show a tattooed number from the Nazi concentration camp. A black man lowered his collar to show that he'd been lynched. Lynched for no crime, but for being black. We suffocate in the slave ships, being wrenched from our loved ones, toiled until only death gave us release. Many others recounted different stories of suffering. Each had their own complaint about God for allowing evil and suffering to happen in this world. How lucky he was to live in heaven, where it was all sweetness and life, where there's no weeping, no fear, no hunger, no hatred. And all agreed that God lived a pretty sheltered life. So each group sent a representative. There was a Jew, a black woman, an untouchable for India, an illegitimate child, a victim from Hiroshima, a sweatshop worker, a prisoner from a labor camp, and in the center of the plane, they consulted. At last, they were ready to present their case. It was daring. But before God could qualify to be their judge, he must endure what they had endured. So a decision was made. God should be sentenced to live on earth as a man. But because he was God, they set certain safeguards to make sure he could not use his divine powers to help him. Let him be born a Jew. Let the legitimacy of his birth be doubted so nobody would really know who his father was. Let him champion a cause so just but so radical that it brings down upon him the hatred and condemnation of the establishment. Let him try to describe what no man has ever seen, tasted, heard, or smelled. Let him try to communicate God to men. Let him be betrayed by his dearest friends. Let him be indicted on false charges, tried before a prejudiced jury and convicted by a cowardly judge. Let him be terribly alone and abandoned. Let him be tortured. Let him then die humiliating death alongside common criminals. As each leader rigorously pronounced their portion of the sentence, there were shouts and approval from the whole crowd. But after that final statement, it was a long pause. No one uttered a word. No one moved. For they all suddenly knew that God had served his sentence. What right has God got? He is God, and as such paid the price for our sins and our wrongdoings, that we can be restored to what he wants us to be. It's not about us. It's not about what we want. It's about what God wants, and we can be restored to be what he wants us to be. To receive the breath of God, to be part of the answer to this world's problems, to journey with God and be willing not just to change, but to be the change by keeping in step with the Lord in all that we do. Come, Holy Spirit, and abide with me. My heart is longing to confide in thee. Such wondrous grace thou hast provided me. Holy Spirit, abide with me. We live in a world that is in such a mess. We live in a church. We belong to a church, and the church has never been so much in need in the world, but yet so small. We are like that valley of the dry bones, needing God to gather us together, to mold us to what he wants us to be, to breathe new life into us. But God never ever forces himself. He waits for us to be invited. In the newsletter, I think Brian made reference to Jesus at the door knocking. That invitation needs to be given. Come, Holy Spirit, and abide with me. Perhaps you might want to do that again. You might want to come and kneel at this place. You might just want to close your eyes and, as you sing this song, say, Lord, come into my life again. Breathe new life into me. Help me to be the change and part of the change in this great city. Holy Spirit, abide in me. We're going to sing this through twice. I'm going to ask Major Elizabeth if she'll just bring us all to God in prayer. Let's sing, shall we?
Thank you. Father, we just thank you. We thank you for this opportunity that you give us to come and to worship you. We know that there are so many things out and around us that can sometimes hinder us and distract us from what you want us to be and do. We are very mindful of the situation around this world, and we especially think of the Ukraine once again and all that has been happening over this last week. We pray for your guidance and your knowledge, Lord, that will be imparted upon those in leadership, and I pray that you will find solutions for all that is going on. Lord, I just pray for them, for their nation, for the leaders, that you will indeed uphold them just now. For the people, we pray for them as they have gone to so many different parts of the world, and I just pray that you will be with them, sustaining them day by day. Lord, we think of ourselves here within this city of Sunderland, and we pray that you will indeed help us to acknowledge you as Lord and Savior. That for us here within this church, that we will be infilled with your Spirit and be able to go out and show your love to others, that will help them to know you more, to know you better, Lord. We are very mindful of those who are not here today, for whatever reason it may be, through illness, maybe just loss of the will to go out and about. For some, it's the confidence to go out. For others, on holiday. We just pray that you will be with each one of them just now. For us here, Lord, as we go from this place, we pray that you will go with us, that your presence will be before us. You will be guiding us and guarding us in every situation that we find ourselves in this week. So, Lord, continue to be with us as we close this day. All these things we ask, and through Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We're going to conclude by singing a great song of praise, a certain newish type of song which is becoming very popular in the church these days. In Christ alone my hope is found. He's my light, my strength, my song, this cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. I love the fourth verse, the second half of the fourth verse. It says, no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand. And we don't do it in our own strength. We don't do it in the strength of the Salvation Army or bless him, the general. We do it in the power of God, the power of Christ. We stand and we make a difference and we try to make this world a better place. So I stand, invite you to stand, and we'll sing the song straight through. Taking the lead from the band. Thank you.
Thank you.
addiction, friends, before we can enjoy some fellowship, some tea and coffee, and for those who receive chocolates, maybe even chocolate together. May the Lord bless thee and keep thee. May the Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace today, tomorrow, and forever. And we unite as a family of believers to say, Amen.